some of the lightweight encryption schemes for cyber physical systems. Okay. So this is definition or how data encryption technique works. That scenario is here. I think we don't need to discuss it anymore because in the previous part I have already told you. Okay. Okay. So this is the formal definition of a crypto system. What I have again discussed here the same thing in the previous presentation, so I'm not going to discuss this slide also. So come to this. What is lightweight cryptography? Okay, so lightweight cryptography is a cryptographic algorithm or protocol runs on low computational cost and suitable for implementation in resource constraint environments. Okay, so some resource constraint environments are, you can see here, radio frequency identification or RFID tags, what you call, then wireless sensor network devices or nodes, which are sensors, contactless smart cards, and Internet of Things devices, and so on. And all of these are part of cyber physical system. So I think you understand that how it is related to cyber physical system. So first one I'm going to show you is one encryption algorithm based on DNA and DNA operations and chaotic map. And next one I will show you where I have used linear feedback shift register as well. So let's go first. Okay. So this is definition of deterministic chaotic system. As I have already told you, chaotic systems are non-linear. It is a dynamical system and which is non-periodic, non-converging, and bounded. And you people are from, I think, a little bit cryptographic background are there. So you understand that all these properties are very, very important for a good cryptographic algorithm. Okay, so that is the reason that nowadays chaotic systems are considered to be used in cryptographic algorithms. Okay, so deterministic system is defined as fx a function, then input is initial condition x and parameter mu, or sometimes we've given it by q, alpha, beta, all these things. Okay, and output is a sequence of states. Okay, so how it looks like, so you have a iterative function here, that is f. Okay, IFS, iterative function system. So f is here, you have some initial parameter as input, you have some initial condition as input to this iterative function, and this function will iterate for n number of times to generate n number of random number or number bit for you, which can be treated as time series as well. Okay, so if you take a little bit depth and example, you can see here how it looks like the iterative function, xk plus 1 equal to tau of xk, and k is varies from 0 to up to n or whatever you give, and x belongs to 0 to 1. So here this tau is the function which iterates with xk every time and is generate x plus k. Okay, and there is an example of chaotic map here that is called chaotic logistic map, which is given by xk plus 1 equal to mu xk into 1 minus xk, where mu belongs to 0 to 4 and xk belongs to 0 to 1. Okay, now this mu is basically called as chaotic parameter. Okay, so when this mu belongs to, if you put the value of mu, or if you choose the value of mu in between this given range 3.56994564 to 4, then this map shows you maximum chaotic behavior, and that means too much random. Okay, and xk is always belongs to range 0 to 1. Okay, so this is one of the simplest and one of the most popular chaotic map used in cryptography. Okay, a very simple map, you can see. this map, you know, this equation you can very easily implement using a for loop even. Okay. Next is come to the DNA operation. So this is another simple thing like a jar. So what happens? So we all know that DNA is having four component, A, T, G, C. I think you all know. Now, if you have four items or four components, and if you just represent them in binary, how many bits you will need? Can you tell me? You will need only 2 bits, right? So it, you can say that, yeah, I will represent A as 00, T as 11, G as 01, C as 10. Done. So you have done this coding. Now some of your friend may come and say, why A is 00? I will put C is 00, A is 10. You can't deny, you know, that choice also. So like this, somebody can again come and say, why 00 is assigned to C? I will assign it to T. Again, you have to accept. No. So in this way, there will be 8 ways to assigning this, you know, 4 combination of these 2 bits to these 4 items. So here it is tabulated. Okay. Now, thing is that when you are using it for cryptography, you have to choose one of them. Okay. So it is not, it should not be like that. The sender is thinking that I am assigning 00 to A, and receiver will say no. When I will decrypt, I will assign 00 to C. Then their algorithm will not work. The thing is that the sender and receiver must agree with one scheme out of this 8. All right. So this is the first thing happens. Next thing is that we can do addition using this rule, like A plus A equal to A plus Z equal to G, A plus C equal to C, A plus T equal to T, because A is 00, so it coming this results. Okay, then if you see, you know, G plus any of these things, it will give this result. C plus any of this thing will give you this result, and T plus any of these things give you these results. Okay, and you can do subtraction as well. Okay. So how do we use this table for encryption? What do we do? We convert our plain text into a DNA sequence like this. Okay. Then we convert. Then we generate, basically. We generate a pseudo random number sequence using the chaotic map. Okay. And that pseudo random number sequence is again converted to another DNA sequence. Now you have two DNA sequence. One is for your plain text, another is for random number. Using this table, you add them together and you will have a resultant DNA sequence that will be treated as encrypted text. Okay, and the receiver will have, you know, pseudo random number sequence and your encrypted DNA sequence, and you subtract and we'll get back the original plain text message sequence. Okay, so this is the concept here. So come here. Yeah, so how this encryption algorithm looks like, you can see here that we have a pseudo random number generator, which is basically the logistic map. Okay. For different purposes, we have used different set of keys. Okay, we have a plain image here. So what we are doing, we are generating a pseudo random sequence R1 first, which is used to shift the rows of the image. Then another R2 we are generating, which is converted to DNA encodes and added them together, and it is giving you one cipher image. Okay, so in first round we have shifted the rows, and also in each row we have encrypted the pixel values using the DNA computation. Next round, what we are doing, we are generating R3, which is another pseudo random number sequence. Using that, we are shifting the columns in the image. Okay, And after the shifting is done, we are generating R4, which is used to, you know, again doing DNA computation to encrypt the columns of the image. And finally, the output is going to give you the encrypted image. Now, if you see the result, we have taken this image as input. Okay, this is the histogram. Okay, after applying that algorithm, we got this encrypted image, and this is the histogram of the encrypted image. So you can see that histogram is too much, you know, uniform. Here, you can, you know, if you know the statistics, few of the statistics of this image, from this histogram, you can guess this histogram belongs to this image. But here, as you know, all the frequency of pixels in this histogram are quite similar, you can guess it. You can statistically guess what was the original image. So you can say this algorithm is worked good. Okay, here is another image we had used. Okay, here is, you know, some of the result we have tabulated. You can see the correlations are, you know, just near to zero, very small. Okay, which is a good quality. Avalanche effects are also, you know, you can see very good. Then irregular deviation, that is also irregular deviation is a property of the histogram. Okay, so you should compare this with uniform histogram. The thing is that you know, how this thing gives you that how much uniform is your histogram, and this is gives you that how much irregular is your histogram. Okay, then NPCR, that means number of pixel change ratio. Okay, so you can see here always it is more than 99. Okay, it should be near to 100, and we have almost near to 100. Okay, and here UACI, so these are UACI value, then PSNR value, which are again good values. 44 and 45 are really good values for PSNR. Entropy is again, you know, we got very good result, which are, you know, say almost near to 8. So for a, you know, 8-bit image, your after encryption, the encrypted image must have entropy near to 8-bit. Okay, and you can see it is very, very near to 8. Okay, so this is how these results are, you know, results we have found using that algorithm. Okay, now do we have enough time? We have time. So now I'm going to show you another algorithm in which we used this LFSR, the chaotic logistic map, and genetic operations. Okay, so this algorithm is a little bit complex from the previous one. It follows a block cipher structure. So this is the example of a linear feedback shift register. So what is linear feedback shift register? It can be given by polynomial like this. Order of this polynomial is 32, means it is having 32 flip-flops. Okay, so they are given here B1 to B32. Okay, so this flip-flop, so what it does, they are connected with a clock. Okay, and in every clock, if you forget about this lower part, what happens in every clock, they basically feed their value to the next flip flop. Okay, so what happens, B1 will just feed its current value to the B2, B2 will B3, and so on, and B32 is the last flip flop where it will feed its value. So it gives its value as output. Okay, so 1-bit output it gives in every clock. Okay, now there is another problem. If B32 is just giving it as output, then B1 is getting vacant from where it will decide its state after, you know, because its previous state is already given to B2. So how it will decide its current state? That is a big problem, problem for B1. So what is the solution? We think, okay, you give a feedback from here to here so that the next next state of B1 can be decided. Now, if you don't have all this circuit, if you have a simple feedback from B32 to B1, then what will happen? You will have initial 32-bit and it is basically circular shifting continuously. So you will going to get a period of 32 of that sequence. Okay. So what is the solution? Solution is you take or select few tap points, okay, and take the capture the bit or states from the tap points and make JOR operation among all these tap points bits, and the result of the JOR you give as a feedback to the B1, so that B1's state every time gets some randomization. Okay, so this is what we have done, and this is what is called as linear feedback shift register. Okay, so this is what we have used, but I think who have already studied cryptography and all, they knows that LFSR is having some drawbacks. Drawback is it is linear, okay, and in cryptography linear things are very easy to break, or for attackers it is very quite simple to break, or easier to break. So we had to convert this to a non-linear system so that attacker should not get that benefit of breaking the linear system and analyze the linear system. Okay, so that I will show you in a little bit next slide. Okay, next you come to genetic representation and operation. So who have studied biology in schools, they all know that chromosomes are there, right? And chromosomes are can be represented like this, okay, in binary in our computer science. So we have say two chromosome A and A dash. Okay, A is 100 10 110, and A dash is 10 10 1100. Okay, now you know, I think you can recall your mind that there is two operations can be done on genes basically, or on chromosomes, right? One was mutation, right? One of them was mutation. Okay, so if you look at the mutation operation, there is few kinds of mutation operation, like inversion mutation, then swap, then scramble, flip, and insert. Okay, so if you see inversion, before mutation you had a chromosome 10 010 1 10. Okay, so after mutation what it becomes, this red bits are got inversed, so that means 0 become 1, 1 becomes 0, so that is inversion. Sure, if you see here that same chromosome after mutation, it's just these two bits, this red bits are swapped their place. Okay, then scramble. You can see these red bits are scrambled here. It was 0 1 1 0, here it become 1 0 0 1. That means this ones have been ones, one and zeros are just changed their places, so it is scrambling. Then flip, you can see it happens in only one place and that bit is just flipped to it inverse. Okay, then insert, that means some bit has been inserted there by due to some reason. Okay, so these are the things. Next operation possible on genes are crossover. So here you can see this is the original gene or chromosome, or original chromosome 10 010 1 1 0. So wait. Sorry for the interruption. So here is the crossover operation. You can say there is two parents here. One is 1100100, and another parent is 01101001. Okay, and this is a multi-point crossover. That means this crossover is happening on two points. You can remember that one point crossover we have seen in our school life, and even multi-point I think we have seen. So you can see how what happened. This gray colored part from the first chromosome is placed here in the second children or child, and from the parent or white parent, this part of the chromosome is shifted here in the first child. Okay, and as a result we got two children chromosome which are generated from these two parent chromosome. Okay, so and they are basically with a new property and basically new sequence of binary bits. Okay, if you consider them as binary bit. Okay. Now you see crossover technique. There is three kind of crossover. One is single point crossover. One is 2 point crossover, and another is uniform multi or uniform points crossover. So in 1 point crossover, as I was telling you, if you look at this parent A and parent B, this red bits and this green bits are the basically this these are the point of where it is going to be crossed over. Okay, so if you see after crossover what happened in the offspring, this part from the A and this part from the B got together and created a new offspring. Okay, and if you see in 2 point crossover, this red bits and this green bits are just showing you the point from where to where it is going to make the crossover. So the blue bits from the A, parent A, are kept in the offspring, and the green bits from the parent B are kept in the offspring. So it is generating a new offspring. Okay, then uniform point, so it is quite multi-point kind of thing. Okay, so you have this blue, this blue bit, then red, then again three blue bits, and so on. And here also you can see here the points you can very easily can point out. Okay, now it uniform because how many points it takes from the how many bits it takes not bit okay how many points it takes from the parent A, that many points it will take from the parent B as well. Now you can see here the result. You have blue bit here from the parent A, you have green bit here from the parent B. Okay, then you have black bit here from the parent B, and you have red bit here from parent A. You understand? So this is what uniform point crossover. Now come to the encryption system. First is what I had told you, that LFSR are having the basic problem of linearity. So we had to convert, we had to change it somehow. We can introduce some of non-linearity into the system. So what we have done, very simple trick, that the linear feedback it was using, we have added one bit to this feedback, which is generated by a chaotic map or chaotic logistic map. Logistic map I have already shown you. So using that map. Okay, so what happens if the attacker is good at breaking linear feedback shift register, he will just got a mistry on this, because it is even it is a linear feedback shift register, but it will behave like a non-linear, because one of the bit every time added to the feedback is generated by some outer system, okay, outer, which is not part of this LFSR, okay, and which is going to add the what is called non-linearity to the generator. All right, next, if you look at this, if you look at this encryption technique, you can see this HF hybrid PRNG, we are calling this random number generator as hybrid PRNG. It is generating 512 bit, which can be divided, which have divided into left part and right part. Okay, so like a pistol cipher we are doing here. Okay, and the plain text we are taking here is 256 bit. Okay, now what we are doing first, that plain text block is doing a JOR with left part of the HPRNG generated. And whatever the result we are getting after doing JOR, it is going for mutation. Okay, so there is some mutation logic we had written, or you can just fix this logic by choosing from the previous slide different kind of mutation we have I've shown you. So any of the mutation you can just fix here, that bits will be muted here using this. Okay, and then it goes for multi-point crossover. So this multi-point crossover, so as when we are doing, there was a concern of how to decide the point. So that point are being decided using the right part of the key. Okay, so using that we have done. Now now see, this right part of the key in the next iteration, this right part of the key is becoming the left part of the key, and the JOR version of the plain text is becoming the right part of the key. Okay, and it is going for n rounds, so and in every round we are taking this, that plain text block is changing. Okay, in pistol cipher that does not happen. Okay, in this part it is totally different from the pistol cipher. Okay, we are taking a new plain text block every time, and we are generating a ciphertext block every time each of the iteration. Okay, and finally n blocks are encrypted and we are getting the result. So the algorithms look like this. Okay, so here are the written thing I'm not going to discuss, because I have discussed it from the diagram itself. Now if you see the security analysis and experimental results, okay, here you can see the we had go for a diehard statistical test for our HPRNG we have designed, and you can see here there is 15 tests, and everywhere our system random number generators generator is passed. Okay, so that is a good one. And next, if you see the result of encryption technique, the Lina image you have encrypted, you can see the histogram changed in the, this is the original image histogram and this is the cipher image histogram. Okay, then we had tried with some biometric image. Okay, because there is difference between this image and this image. This is a real gray level image, that you can see the histogram. Almost all the gray levels of the color are having some frequency. Now if you see here in the biometric image, this color or gray levels are almost zero. Here you have some pixels which are near to zero value, and some pixels we are getting which are near to 250 to 255. Okay, so this is a challenging these are the challenging image to encrypt. So you can see it is encrypted very well, and see the histogram totally changed. Okay, next we have used with on a color image as well. So this is the color image, and it was the histogram of the color image. Okay, and after encryption we got this encrypted image, and this is the histogram of the encrypted image. So you can understand the quality, it is really good. Okay, so key space analysis, this algorithm has a key space of 2 to the power 2 61, that means 261 bits. Okay, however it is, it can be increased based on the requirements. Okay, here are the correlation coefficients calculated for different images. You can see compared with AES algorithm, if we have compared with AES algorithm, we have compared with another method proposed by Fu, another method Li et al., another by Zhao. Okay, and this is our method. So you can see in our, if you see the first one, horizontal correlation coefficient for Lena. See, for AES, if you are using, it is coming 0.03 something. Okay, here 0.02, here 0.28. Here 0.2 again. In our case, you can see 0.004. So our algorithm is giving at least 10 times better correlation coefficient in the encrypted image. So this is the thing. Here is NPCR and UACI values are compared. Okay, so here PSNR and entropy values are compared, and you can see PSNR and these values are really good for our encryption algorithm. Okay, then I think this is the performance analysis in term of amount of time taken for encryption. Okay, so you can see in all the cases our time requirement is much later than the other thing or other algorithms. Okay, so this is what here are some references. So thank you. This was for today. Now if you have any question, you may please ask me. Okay, so by the way, I think participants, you have my email ID and other contact, other means. So if you have any doubt in later also, you can just contact me, you can drop me a mail, I'll help you. Okay. Sorry, I had disconnected. Okay.
Good morning, best of your speaker of the day.